I want to invite you to turn your Bibles. If you don't have one, there's one in the pew there. Mark chapter 6. We're studying through the Gospel of Mark. We're looking at the second half of verse 6 through all the way down through verse 32. I'm going to read the scriptures within my message today. I don't know if you know this or not, but on the back of your program, we always leave a blank page if you want to take notes or jot something down, and we put a sermon title there. The title this Sunday for my message is, Why We Go. Knowing that we have some nurses in our church, I just want to let you know that title is not referring to a physical necessity or a biological reason, but why we go for another reason you'll soon to find out. Father God, anytime I sit down before your word, Lord, and I say, okay, Father, what do you have for your flock? And I always find myself surprised. Why should I be? The Spirit, thank you, that you lead and direct. And so as hungry and thirsty people do the same again now, in the powerful name of Jesus, amen and amen. That title, Why We Go, is because, and I wasn't planning this, it just worked out this way, is that our passage, as I read it, I think you're going to find out, is really a missionary text. Now, when I refer to missions or missionaries, I don't want you clicking off, because today's message is very, very relevant to us. And it's very relevant to Grace Calvary Church, because our church makes a very serious commitment to supporting missionaries. But in that regard, questions often come up when you think of missionary families. Like, why would a sweet family with five little kids, who, if they wanted to, could live among the beautiful cornfields of Nebraska, where Brad Harris is from, why would Brad and Ellie Harris take five little babies, little children, and move to an impoverished nation like Kenya? Why would they do that? Or why would our former youth pastor Casey and Valerie leave their position here at Grace Calvary? Leave the beautiful home that was provided for them in Manahawkin. Why would Casey and Valerie move away from family and close friends to go to Vanuatu, that whenever people say, where do you have missionaries? They say, well, we have one in Vanuatu, and they look at you like, Vanuatu? And if you ever get out one of those world globes, you know the one that you used to spin when you were in school, when you were bored and you went up to the teacher and you look, what does Vanuatu look like on a globe? Just like a little dot. Why would Casey and Valerie give up the life that they've had here? Casey's sister even lives here on the East Coast. Why would they do that to go someplace else? Why would Carol Joseph, a single woman who for years now, I mean year after year, sending us letters telling us, pray for me, I'm going to be in New York City this week, standing on a street corner telling other Jewish people, because Carol's Jewish, telling other Jewish people that Jesus is my Messiah. Pray for me, I'm going to Jerusalem. We're not really welcome there, especially with the message of Yeshua. Why would someone do, why would Debbie Krugel, why would Debbie, New Jersey girl, not married, why would she educate, oh my word, when we interviewed Debbie, knows languages, and is, she's so intelligent, has so much giftedness, why would Debbie first move to Mexico and lived also in an impoverished area, and then find herself in Malawi, Africa? Why would somebody do that? You know, it's one thing to think about how these families risk their health, but what about their children's well-being? Where are these kids going to go to school? How are they going to learn? Well, that's not the only question to get asked about why we go. And sometimes people will say, well, you know, why are we expending money for overseas missions when there's so much need in our own backyard? Have you ever said that or heard somebody say that? Linda and I have a friend who's a nurse. It's a good career. Why would she, and I won't mention her name, you're going to understand why in just a moment. Why would she move to Afghanistan and live in a neighborhood with the Taliban at risk of her life and still today be in service there? Why would someone do that? Trust me, these issues, these questions I'm raising are very real. Real enough to say that when a grandparent tells a missionary daughter this, you took my grandchildren from me when you went to the mission field. Do you know that the number one obstacle for those who go? Why does this message matter anyway? Because we have people from our own fellowship who have gone. That's why it counts. That's why it matters. It's not actually raising financial support. Do you know that the number one obstacle to people going to the mission field is their parents? You see, it's one thing if it's someone else's child is going overseas, but God forbid it's your own child who comes home one day and says, Mom, I think God's calling me to Dad. I think God's calling me to the mission field. It's against this backdrop that we come to the second half of verse 6 through verse 13, where we're going to see that the Lord Jesus sent out missionaries from his own inner circle of disciples. Here's why I say that. Look at the second half of verse 6. And he was going about the villages, around the villages, teaching. It's referring to Jesus. And he summoned the 12, and he began to send them out in pairs, and he was giving them authority over the unclean spirits, and he instructed them that they should take nothing for their journey except a mere staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belt, but to wear sandals. And he added, don't even put on two tunics. And he said to them, wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the town. And any place that doesn't receive you or listen to you, as you go out from there, shake off the dust from the soles of your feet for a testimony against them. And they went out and they preached that people should repent. And they were casting out many demons and were anointing with oil many sick people and healing them. Now notice with me, the disciples were what? They were sent out. That's what we mean when we call somebody a missionary. Someone who's been sent out from us. Now, who were they sent out by? They were sent out by the Lord Jesus. I want you to think about this. The Heavenly Father sent His only begotten Son. The Heavenly Father also sent the Holy Spirit to help His Son. And now the Son sends out from His own inner circle of disciples a band of missionaries who are to go out and to glean those harvest fields that Jesus refers to later as white unto harvest. It reminds me of the cotton fields in South Carolina when we used to go on vacation down there. Now, I never did this, but whenever those cotton fields, whenever the cotton, you know, was ready to be picked, I've always been tempted to pull off the road because you just feel like, yay. I know, I'm sorry, Sharon, I got that side to me. But any of you, oh, come on now, you see a good cornfield and you start thinking to yourself, that's a lot of corn, you know. All right, well, either confess that sin now or bring it to the Lord after church, whatever. But, you know, I just picture the Lord saying this, there's so many people who are going to come. And the Lord's, verse 7, he sent them out in pairs, two are better than one. They had a companion that would go along with them. But do you notice they also had very limited resources, didn't they? They weren't to have even a second change of clothes. Why? They weren't even allowed to carry a stale Pop-Tart in their bag or a sleeping bag. Now, why do you think the Lord was doing that? Because he wanted to teach his disciples what? Absolute dependency. Faith in God. And the Lord also, in verses 10 and 11, he schooled his disciples. He said to them, look, I want you to be able to discern what are open doors and what are closed doors. If you're welcomed in a town, stay there. Minister. Preach the gospel. But if you're rejected, shake the dust off your sandals as a sign of their rejection and of God's judgment. But you know, in one sense, while it seems as if they went out with very little, they actually went out with much. And in this case, they went out in the anointing power of the Holy Spirit. You have to realize, think about this, up until this time, who was doing all the miracles? Jesus. Actually, just Jesus. John the Baptist wasn't even doing miracles. Jesus was doing the miracles. And now, can you picture, you say, hey, Peter, you can do now what I do. And so they're sent out by the Lord. They're working these mighty miracles. Verse 7 says they even had authority over the demonic realm, didn't they? But what was their primary mission? Why were they really going? Well, we learned there in verse 12, it was to preach the gospel. It was to call people to repentance. Now, I want you to think about this. Now, if the Father sent the Son, and he did, and if the Son sent out his 12 disciples, and he did, what does that tell us as God's people about the issue of missions? I think the answer is, missions is a ministry that comes from the heart of God. Because the Lord God sent his only begotten Son, right? To die for our sins, to be buried, to rise again, to call people to repentance and belief in his name. Here's how I want to put it this way. What very practically does missions mean for you and me? Why is it important? And it's a very short statement, but think about this. Without missions, you and I would be lost. Because every one of us in this room who know the Lord Jesus as Savior, at some point in our lives, someone had to have spoken the word of truth to us in order to believe. And we could say, whoever that person was, whether it was a parent, a friend, a Sunday school teacher, an Awana teacher, whoever that person was, they were God's missionary in your life to bring you to Jesus Christ. It's interesting how God works, timing stuff. When I came, like I said, to the text, I wasn't even thinking about missions until I realized what this passage was really doing. And on Thursday, I don't know if you got it, but on Thursday I got that prayer update, that email from Brad and Ellie Harris in Kenya. I was intrigued by what the story Brad was telling there. You know, we have this, and if you're not part of our church or just visiting today, we have this couple in Kenya, and Brad has begun to teach other African pastors the Bible. You have to realize that a lot of the African pastors have never been to Bible college. They've never been to seminary. Many of them have never taken Bible training classes. In fact, according to Brad, and it's the story that I'm going to tell, is that oftentimes these pastors themselves aren't even necessarily born again. Well, there was a man who began coming to one of the Bible studies that Brad was leading. And Brad tells a story. He says, you know, he's kind of frustrated because he was teaching through the book of Jude. Jude's like, what, 23, 24 verses, whatever long. It's a little short book. And Brad said it was just like, it just felt like it was going on and on and on and on. And he was wondering, is anybody getting anything out of this? And this man, Thomas, one of the pastors, came to faith in Christ. But Thomas is a pastor of a group called the Rojos. Now, that's just the name of, I'm not making that up. That's R-O-H, Rojos, okay? Sounds like a gang, doesn't it? From New York City, the Rojos, a biker gang. And, well, this guy's the leader of that group. Well, Brad's now begun to hear that Thomas is really stirring the pot. Because he's still involved with this group of people who don't know the Lord, but Thomas is now preaching the gospel to all the Rojos. You know, it'd be like saying some guy got saved in the Hell's Angels and he's gone back and he's now telling all the Hell's Angels about Jesus Christ. Are you getting what I'm saying here? Now, Brad said this is creating, you know, a great big mess because, the, you know, there's leadership in the Rojos that are saying, what's this guy doing? And of course, Brad's saying Thomas is going to have to make some major decisions about his own ministry life. But, you know, from a distance, I just think about the fact here we are on LBI, thousands of miles away, but because we're standing behind the Harrises, God is reaching people that you and I will probably, how many of you are planning a vacation to Kenya? You know, there might be somebody, I don't know. You're thinking, hey, come on now, Pastor, you're joking, right? Well, see, that's my point. These people are reaching people that we probably might never touch. But in the midst of this story about sending out the 12, all of a sudden, Mark shifts the story and talks about John the Baptist. Now, we're going to figure out why in just a moment, but let me suggest this, that in the midst of how the Lord sent his own disciples out as missionaries, we discover in the story of John the Baptist's life that the cost of missions can also come at great sacrifice. Here's what I say that. Look at verse 14. And King Herod heard of it. He heard about the Lord's disciples going out, for his name had become well known. And people were saying, and they were saying this about Jesus, John the Baptist has risen from the dead. And that's why these miraculous powers are at work in him. But others were saying, he's Elijah. And others were saying, he's a prophet, but like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard it, he kept saying, John, whom I beheaded, has risen. For Herod himself had sent and had John arrested and bound in prison on account of Herodias, the wife of his brother Philip, because he had married her. For John had been saying to Herod, it's not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted him, that is John, to be put to death and couldn't do so. For Herod was afraid of John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he kept him safe. And when he heard him, he was very perplexed, but he used to enjoy listening to him. And a strategic day came when Herod, on his birthday, seems to be a lot of birthdays this week, it's a great context, gave a banquet for his lords and military commanders and the leading men of Galilee. And when the daughter of Herodias herself came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his dinner guests. And the king said to the girl, ask me for whatever you want, and I will give it to you. And he swore to her, whatever you ask of me, I will give it to you up to half of my kingdom. And she went out and she said to her mother, what shall I ask for? And she said, the head of John the Baptist. Well, immediately she came in haste before the king and she asked, saying, I want you to give to me right away the head of John the Baptist on a platter. And although the king was very sorry, and yet because of his oaths and because of his dinner guest, he was unwilling to refuse her. And immediately the king sent an executioner and commanded him to bring back his head. And he went and he had him beheaded in the prison and brought his head on a platter and gave it to the girl. And the girl gave it to her mother. And when the disciples heard about this, they came and took away his body, which, by the way, was without the head, and laid it in a tomb. Now, see, here's the thing. Why does the Gospel of Mark go from the story about the 12 disciples going out as missionaries and then all of a sudden shift gears and go to this story about John the Baptist when we know that right after the story about John the Baptist, he goes right back to talking about the 12 disciples whom Jesus has sent out? Why is John's story sandwiched in the middle of this passage? And I think the answer is because the 12 disciples were sent out as missionaries. And in the context of being missionaries, there was an important message that also needed to be communicated. And that was to say that the cost of missions themselves, the cost is very high. The cost could even come at the sacrifice of someone's life. Now, you know this, You know, for example, we have Fox's Book of Martyrs. It's a Christian book that documents many people who have died for the name of Jesus. You know, when you study the Gospel of Acts, oftentimes people will refer to Stephen as the first martyr. Stephen may have been the first martyr after the Holy Spirit came in Acts chapter 2, but Stephen was not the first martyr. John the Baptist wasn't even the first martyr. Because do you remember how Jesus said why God had sent prophets after prophets whom they had persecuted, they had tormented, they had even killed? Now, nothing about John's beheading is justifiable, is it? John, verse 18, had simply told Herod the truth. You're married to your brother's wife, and you shouldn't be, and it amounts to really, in this case, to really living in adultery. Of course, that got John thrown into prison. Now, Herod, as you know, he didn't want to kill John, but then Herod throws a party, and his wife's daughter, now just think about this. The woman he's married to, the woman he's living with, her daughter comes and she dances before all the people are there, the men, the women. I've read commentaries, I've heard messages on this passage. Many have said, well, mate, she most likely was scantily dressed, was most likely dancing in a seductive. What we're getting here is that Herod, whose fleshly passions are inflamed for his wife's daughter, as a fleshly man, just caught up in the moment, probably having had too much to drink, says, you can even have half of my kingdom if you want it. But he never imagined that she would ask for John the Baptist's head, which is what she did. And if you think about it, it's kind of a sick story, isn't it? The idea, you know, when, you know, a head coming in on a platter, the blood oozing, and it being passed around the room. John was not only God's prophet, John was God's missionary. And John was not only innocent, there was no justifiable reason for his death. And that's why he died as one of the Lord's martyrs. The truth of the matter is, people who go, people who serve God in missions, oftentimes do serve God at the risk of life. I heard it said years ago, and I believe this is true, that a missionary is like the point on the end of the spear. They really are going on the front lines, you know, against not only just natural things, but forces of darkness. I remember years ago when Brad and Ellie were still here with the church and they were interviewing with the missions committee, and it was a really difficult conversation because the issue of sacrifice came up, and a lot of people had some very serious questions about them going to, you know, where they were going to go in Kenya. And Brad, being Brad, and we know how Brad is, he just kind of made the comment. He says, well, you know, Ellie and I are willing to go even at the cost of our own lives. And you could just, you know, you could have heard the deadpan silence around the room. And then Brad, being Brad, probably said what was not necessary to say, but Brad, being Brad, he said, even at the cost of one of our children. Now, I'll tell you, that went down like a lead balloon, especially hearing that. But I want to say right here and now, Brad and Ellie have been two of the most responsible parents that I can give testimony, and I think you know that, and that when they have been in situations involving their children, they have totally acted responsibly. But hearing that verbalized, that's raw, isn't it? Hearing that. But you know, as raw as it is, it's true. It's true. There's a long history of thousands of missionaries and people who have gone out, who who have lost their lives for Christ. You know, Africa used to be known as the missionary's graveyard. Back in the day when people would go to Africa and when they said goodbye to their family and friends, you know, there weren't airports, they were getting on boats. When they said goodbye, it wasn't see you later. It was most likely goodbye, we'll never see you ever again. And many, many, many people died to share the Lord Jesus in lands that most of us would never want to visit. I have to tell you that, you know, when you go to another country, well, when you go on vacation, they're glad to have you there. Why? Because you spend money. But I want to tell you, when you go to those same countries that you might go to on a vacation, if you go there as a missionary, you're now known as a resident alien. Whenever I would hear that word alien, what does that make you think of? Like, what am I, from another planet or something, right? When you go to another country, you're not welcomed at the airport. You're interviewed with suspicion. I remember when our family first moved to Ireland, we flew through England. And as we were going through that airport, one of the British officials was asking me, why is your family moving to Ireland? And so I was trying to explain that as carefully as possible. And this is what he said to me. What makes you think, and he said it rather sternly, what makes you think they want you there? And you know what, in my mind, I thought to myself, the truth of the matter is they don't want me there. But I wasn't going to tell him that, because we also had other missionaries who later on, we told people, please don't fly through there, but someone did, and they almost got put back on the plane, sent back to America. They don't want you there. Being a missionary is being in a country where they don't want you there. Don't make any mistake. You know, we might hear good stories and encouraging stories about what our missionaries are doing, but don't for a minute think that Satan and demonic forces, unsaved people, want Casey and Valerie in Vanuatu. Don't for a minute think that spiritual forces of darkness want Brad preaching and teaching the gospel to pastors who are going to go back to their churches and share Jesus Christ. It's a reminder to say is that the story of John the Baptist is really a strong warning and to us about the rawness of missions itself, that people who serve as missionaries really are on the front lines in serving God. And that's one of the reasons why as a church we remember to pray for them, right? In fact, when Casey and Valerie went to Vanuatu, I began to get the conviction that in my pastoral prayer every week, because Brad and Ellie also came out of our church, that we have a responsibility every week to remember them and to remember that they're a part of us, aren't they? You know, we follow them just that carefully. Now, do you notice back in verses 30 and 30 through 32, it shifts from the story of John the Baptist right back to the 12 disciples. And the 12 missionaries come home, and what do? They go on a retreat. Yeah, that's really what they do. Look at verse 30. The apostles gathered together with Jesus, and they reported to him all that they had done and taught. And he said to them, come away by yourselves to a lonely place and rest a while. What is that? That's a retreat, isn't it? For there were many people coming and going, and they didn't even have time to eat, and they went away in the boat to a lonely place by themselves. Verse 30 tells us that when they came back as missionaries, they needed time to be by themselves so they could process everything that happened. By the way, this is the first time in the Gospel of Mark that disciples are called apostles. Apostles is the same word for being sent out. And what do? They gather together with Jesus. Why did they gather with Jesus? To swap stories. Peter, what happened with you? James, what happened with you? They were swapping stories. And they told Jesus everything they had done, what they had taught. And can you imagine this? And Peter, you know, Lord, we saw you heal blind eyes. We got to do it. Jesus, I saw a lame guy walk. oh, Jesus, there was this one man, I was sharing, talking about you, and he hit his knees, and he repented, and he's trusted in you as Lord and Savior. All these exciting things. But Jesus, hearing all their testimony, verse 31, what does he care for them about? He says to them, fellas, let's go away to a lonely place and rest a while. Jesus understood that they had a real need for spiritual renewal in verse 32. Here's the thing I want to say this. A number of our missionaries aren't with us right now because they're out on the field serving God. But oftentimes when they come home to us, you know, they look perfectly normal, you know. Like to say, you know, we're all a little older and all like that. But otherwise, they look. But you know what? Lots of times they're worn out. They're exhausted. They're burned out. They may have physical needs that you know, that are going on within their family. I remember years ago when Linda and I came home one time, we went to a conference where there were other missionaries. I remember seeing a lady, a missionary for years. She was on the point of insanity because she had gone through so much. You know what kind? She was in France, where people go to Paris on vacation. But in service to God and for the things that she was going through, there was a high cost. Here's what I want to say. When Brad and Ellie come home from Kenya, or when Casey and Valerie come back from Vanuatu, church family, don't be afraid to personally spoil them. And don't expect them to ask either. When Brad and Ellie come home, they'll call up our church office and they'll say, we want to bring pizza in for the staff. And we're always like, no, we should be buying pizza for you. But you know, this is the kind of missionaries we have. They have such huge servant hearts. And I want to share something with you. It's personal. And it's not to pat a member of my own family on the back. But I just want to give this to you as an illustration that maybe God will touch you in the future about. When Brad and Ellie were home the last time, my wife Linda took Ellie out shopping, and she took her to a store, and she says, now, Ellie, we're going to buy clothes for you, whatever you want to buy. And you know what she did? First thing is, Ellie wanted to pick out stuff for her kids. And Linda had to say to her, no, 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 no. Ellie, you're always taking care of the kids, which she does. But this is our opportunity to spoil you. You know, you think about this. These people really are at great cost working for the Lord. We really should spoil them and love on them and do little extra things for them to make their... When the Harrises came back, the first thing, I'm ready to speak in church. I says, no, you're not. You're ready to rest. Well, what do you... I don't want you to do anything, Brad. You know, they were staying with Meg and Paul Dalton. They have a pool in the backyard, and we were joking about it because Meg was like, yeah, I was trying to tell them, go out in the pool. I'll make dinner. Don't worry about it. Right? Because we need to love on these people. It's an honor. It's an honor, folks, for God's church to support missionaries is what I want to say. It's an honor because we're also participating in our God, who is the one who has the greatest missionary heart of them all. I really believe that missions is at the heart of God. And so, if I could ask you, do you have a program today, a bulletin, as you were coming into the church? Could you turn to that announcement page that I kind of glossed over this morning, but actually I did it intentionally. At the bottom of the announcements page, which is in the very center of our bulletin, I asked our secretary this week to put the address of those two missionary families that have gone out of our church, Brad and Ellie Harris and Casey and Valerie Ellis, as well as their emails. Some of you like to write letters, snail mail, put it in the mail with stamps and stuff. Others of you like to write emails. I felt, here's something very practical we could do this week as a church. Why don't we all write them a note, send a letter, and allow these two missionary families to be reminded, we haven't forgotten you. We love you. We appreciate it. In fact, if you don't even know them, you could just say to them, hey, I happen to be in your church, and I heard about you, and I just want to say, though I don't know you by face, I'm praying for you by name. We need to do this, folks, because oftentimes when they've been out in the field for a while, and both of these families have, for us, just like for them, what happens? Life goes on, right? Let's this week send a trickle, a flood of little notes and emails to these missionary families and encourage them. Father God, I thank you, Lord God, for your missionary heart, that for anyone in this room who knows Jesus Christ, it was because someone dared to share Jesus. And when we're, Lord, there in that day in your presence, and we'll look around, that glorious day is going to be a day filled with missionaries, moms and dads who shared with their children, friends, neighbors, those who have gone out, as many have from our church and from other churches, Lord. May we, Father God, may we never have the heart that is stubborn, that thinks, oh, why are we doing that? No, Lord God, there are people who are lost and dying. There are men and women and boys and girls who need to hear about Jesus. And I pray, Lord, that they will. And I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, amen and amen.